days, our speaker is here to answer the age-old question of how can we be seen? And what does it take to make your ad stick to your targeted consumers? Here with new findings from a groundbreaking neuroscience and eye-tracking study to address these questions, please welcome our first speaker. If you are a seasoned MMA attendee, you will know him very well, the Managing Director of APAC of MMA, Mr. Rohit Dadwal.
Good morning, everybody. Good morning, everybody. Great. So as my topic says, it's all about the first second. So it's the first second. People say the first impression counts. It's the first impression that makes a difference, whether we are, whether how we perceive people, how we perceive work, how we perceive architecture, etc. And that's really what I'm going to talk about, the first second. So without further ado, let me get into this. This is a video.
For a pit stop, time to refuel and change tires. Lumore himself changes the tires. Only four crew members, including the driver, are allowed to work on the car. It's a tense time. Holland stays in his seat, anxious to get away. Let's watch. Tires are changed at last. A crewman polishes the windshield as Holland moves away just 67 seconds after he stopped.
So that was 1950, Indianapolis Grand Prix. This is what happens now. That's the difference. That's the difference, and time is relative. The reason why I started with these two videos is we are, the way we are looking at advertising over the last few decades, whether it's TV, print, etc., it is relative on how we perceive those advertising. What's the story of that ad from the time it comes to your screen and you interact and engage with that? Advertising. So what we are going to talk about is the first second strategy. And this actually has been accomplished by a neuroscience study that we've conducted and a research with MIT and a couple of other partners. It is done for the first time. It has never been done before. And it talks about the journey of the advertising of how it starts from the screen and how you proceed with that when you look at that advertising. We use this video to open the session because, as I said, it's the journey of the ad that I am going to talk about today. From the moment it comes on your screen and you interact, there's something that happens in between. That is cognition. That is what your mind processes the ad before you act or interact with that. And this study is done based on that neuroscience. The end goal is to prove with scientific evidence that we've been thinking about this journey all along. As I said at the beginning, I believe we've been thinking about advertising all along. I'm going to prove that to you that we've been thinking that all wrong. And when I say I am going to prove that, that's a big statement. But at MMA, we are sticking our neck out and saying, we have the proof for you guys to start thinking. So if there's one thing that you're going to take away from this session today, is the way you really think about what you do with your advertising in that first second. So, advertising. Okay. The problem of attention is not new. This was an article, a statement Samuel Johnson made. But when he made, you need to see that, in 1759. If this was true then, imagine what it is today. It has to be far greater. And in 250 years later, we are still struggling to get this right. In our opinion, we assume that the industry has a linear relationship between time and exposure, and obviously impact, suggesting that if we control the first, we will control the other two. But that's not true. It doesn't happen in a linear fashion. We are all doing this as a herd mentality, if you will. If somebody is doing 30 seconds, we are doing 30 seconds. If TV started 60 seconds, we started doing 60 seconds. Radio started 1 minute jingle, we started. I think that has been the case. According to the Harvard Business Study recently published, the cost of time and attention has skyrocketed 7x in the last 3 decades. 7x, that's the price of advertising right now. We don't really have that research that proves that there's a relationship and the nature of that relationship, but what we have is to prove that it works different. This is where our research comes in. The best way to describe is that we put cognition in the center. And what we are trying to do is to focus on the first 3 seconds. And we've only mapped the first 3 seconds. Yes, there's all this debate about effectiveness of advertising, but we are not talking about that right now. What we are talking about is the scope of attention and cognition. What happens in the first 3 seconds? Do you actually pay attention to the advertising? Do you interact with the advertising? Do you even get stimulated by looking at that ad and then starting to do or interact or engage with that ad? What happens later after the first 3 seconds is effectiveness. And this study that we've done is not looking at that. So this study is very clearly on the phase one, all about understanding the first few seconds. The most of the existing work in this nature is focused on attention, has been in the past focused on attention or reaction. The obvious gap that we figured out and we are trying to work on is what happens between that and inside your brain. So this is the first study which have passed the ARF certification. Phase one is about methodology, study design, statistical analysis, and obviously replication of these analyses by others. So that's the context of what I'm going to present. I've put up big claims about the advertising that has been done in the past is wrong. Now I'm gonna give you five facts based on this study. The first fact is cognition is fast. Human brain needs less than half a second to engage with mobile advertising and trigger a reaction. This is something that we've done and proven. Cognition, 67% of all ads were perceived to be paid attention to within 0.4 millisecond, not even a full second, 0.4 millisecond. And 2/3 are cognitively recognized in the 0.4 seconds. Cognitively recognizing means you've started to understand that ad, and then you will start to work on that. So that's the first point. Second is, time is relative. And ads in a mobile feed environment get attention faster and trigger a much stronger cognition compared to desktop. And to prove that, this is the data. About 60% of desktop ad exposures are seen at 2 to 3% on the same cognition study that we did. But on a mobile, 67%, as I said, is less than 0.5%. The third fact that we've proven is our brand, our brain is faster on branding. So is this a level playing field for all brands? That's the question people ask. Our brain is faster on branding because cognitively it is processing the known brands faster. As simple as that. Well-known brands convert attention to stronger emotion. And this, but there's no difference in the attention it gets. There's a, the attention in the 0.4 seconds that it drives for future engagement and interaction is no different than an unknown brand. Cognitive load of a human mind, the way it processes it, is the same. And the motivation to interact and engage will be decided in those, that millisecond. Am I clear on this? This is little scientific, but I do want to. I am not a scientist. I'm just presenting what their findings are. So these the five facts that I'm presenting, I will show you at the end as to why and what are the best practices. So motion drives, the fourth fact is motion drives emotion. What happens with different formats? Short format, long format, what notion drives and what's the meaning of a video ad which creates more emotion and more response than static ad? Is that true? Something that we've worked. It is particularly important, again, that we assume that video needs twice the time versus static to create opportunity based on the viewability standards. But that, again, is not true. Because you have only initiated 0.4 seconds of that animation of a video. So that drives the emotion, not the video. So the animation could be on both GIF or video per se. Video ads generate stronger emotion response and get similar level of attention to static. So now the difference is attention is not emotional. You get the same attention, but you drive a different emotion. And that all happens within this time. And the last, but the, not the least, is weak ads work fast, but they fail faster. It, if these emotions of the first second are true, and the way it works, then the ads are much more likely to fail if they are weak, not because they are not known. Because the cognitive, the research that we've done has proven to us is that the attention that they get is the same. But that's where it starts to generate lower cognitive emotion. So in the 0.4 seconds that you get the attention of the ad, it will be the same. But if your ad is not relevant, not according to the need of the feed, etc., it will drop that much faster. So it, the low performing ads, just to show you the data, has lower attention span. And because the attention span is low, the emotions that help trigger the reaction and engagement in the first second start to drop. And that's why those ads fail. So to summarize, the trouble is that we think we have time. This is something Lord Buddha said ages back. And I think it's still true even today. And what we are trying to do is to prove that time being relative is the first second that really matters. And do we really have a first second strategy? So as brand marketeers, as agencies, as publishers, whenever you're looking at doing this, whenever you're looking at going forward, of what you need to think about is to think about your first second. So before we go to the list of the best practices that we've created, on these learnings. We have creative best practices, which we believe will be very helpful for everybody. I want to show you and sort of prove to you that what we are talking about, that our brain, which is a wonderful machine, processes things differently than what we perceive them to be. And the video that I'm going to show is, after this, is based on historic measure. From ages since human beings, we are processing things differently. We are recognizing things differently. Our eyes were positioned to recognize animals so that we can defend ourselves. Even today, ages later, we still can do that. It is wired differently. It does not change. And that's what the cognitive load is proving. And millions of years later, even today, we can spot an animal the way our ancestors were doing it to save their lives. It is just, and these are the shortcuts that our brain has got used to, which we don't really know how it works. And that's where the cognitive load of this study. So I'm going to share with you an example and prove that attention can be manipulated. So can we go back to this video? Sound, please.
To test just how much attention the attention-stealing design of the new Skoda Fabia actually steals, we left one parked on this ordinary road in West London. We wanted to see if its sharp crystalline shapes, bold lines, and lower, wider profile would attract the desired level of attention. Will the 17-inch black alloy wheels stop passers-by in their tracks? Will the angular headlights attract the attention of other road users? Will a crowd gather to check out its fresh, sporty look? Well, not quite. But did the attention-stealing design distract you from noticing that the entire street has been changing right before your very eyes? Don't believe us? Have another look. Did you spot the van changing to a taxi? How about the scooter changing to a pair of bicycles? Or the lady holding a pig? Let alone the fact that the entire street is now completely different. Didn't think so. So there we have it. Proof that the new Skoda Fabia is true.
Show of hands, how many actually realized all that happened? One hand, please. If you've not seen the ad before, you've seen the ad before. It can be manipulated. It's very easy. And that blink of an eye in the video is what's your mind processing that? That's the 1 second that it takes to change and perceive and manipulate what you think. So here's the checklist. Based on this, if that's the proof that we've been able to establish, let me give you a quick few examples of what you could do. A blur can trigger an emotion. This sounds weird. Before we can even see what's on your screen, and when it's all blur, we can still see the colors. And colors trigger a specific emotion. In China, red in a stock market is good. Anywhere else in the world, it is not. So in China, red has a different color. But otherwise, red is love and passion, green is life and health. So it does amount to the fact that when you are working with your colors on your creatives, I'm sure the creative teams would be doing that, you need to keep thinking about this. Second, we also need to remember that in most feed environments, the logo appears first in the feed environment, in the mobile feed environment. In that way, it will get prime viewership and it will get that attention. And as I mentioned earlier, well-known brands will get that attention even faster than unknown brands. But that doesn't mean the motivation to work with it will be different, because motivation is what will drive the reaction or interaction. Attention will be the same. and there's a U-shape, likelihood of detection. That basically proves that emotional response with familiar ads will drive both positive and negative reaction even faster, because it's a brand that you care for or a brand you don't have any idea of. So it will. Third is visual elements that determine the stopping power or the attention. It's a balancing act between visual elements, if you're looking at just static, contrast, angles, and colors. They all play a role. Overall, ads contain everything. They are not just one of these three. And the salient features of an ad, whether it's contrast, color, or shape, will help drive that. So for example, in this tall building, you have contrast, you have very fine shape, and you also have a color of the pig wearing red. So what will drive your attention first will be those three things, not the background, not the mix. That's how the cognition and the cognitive load. On the other hand, for some, it'll be the color of the pig that will drive attention. And that's what will trigger the emotion. Net, it is a balancing act, and you need to have all these perspectives in mind from a creative practice as to what you are trying to drive, where are you trying to drive attention. And also, working with complexity. The term complexity by itself on a mobile feed or a mobile environment is even more complex. Because if you are in a Facebook environment, for example, or Google search or YouTube, when you're going through it, there are so many things that you're looking at the same time. And you need to look at the platform complexity and see that in the ad in the context of platform. So if it's a complex item, the platform needs to be more simple. But if it's a complex platform, your ad needs to be simpler. That's where the attention will be driven. And that is also proven on this small image, which is very simple, but where the attention is. And all these are actual tracking of the cognition study that we've done. If you see that the cognition load was processing that part of the image, which is very simple. And that helps you drive what you're trying to get in terms of how you manage complexity between high complexity environment and a low complexity ad or vice versa. The other creative best practice is motion drives emotion. So if you have a motion-based image, even in a static image, it will drive attention faster than a perceived non-motion image. Humans respond very strongly to faces, body parts, and even icons. And even incomplete faces in this ad, for example, will drive more attention and will drive attention first than to the box. And as we all know, asymmetric faces obviously drive more attention. The other two parts, I'll just take a minute more. I am a minute over my time. Even gaze of direction matters. So these are two examples. This is demanding attention. So when you're looking, when your ad and the person in the ad is looking straight at you, is demanding attention to himself or herself. But when you're looking at something else, it's directing your attention. So if you were to look at these two ads, you will see those puppies first, then the dog. And here you will see the man. And what we've done is, just to prove to you, this is how this ad showed. When the lady was looking straight at you, and the brand and the product was there and not there, that's the first second of transition of an eye and the cognitive load, what it looked at in the ad. Versus this, where the direction of the retina was on the product, and then from the product to the message. This is what we tested. So all these studies were done. These were some of the ads that were done. And this is where the best practices. So quickly, the creative checklist is using colors. How are we using colors? What are we doing with contrast angles, using motion, making first frames of a video count? And the reason I'm reading them is these are informed choices. Marketeers, agencies in the room, publishers need to look at that, because at the end of the day, it's the first second that we are trying to drive interaction and engagement with. And it's all triggering these social needs or adjusting familiarity with the brand. And also, what is also very important is the media. Are we winning attention instead of paying for it? And that's very important, because today we are talking about CPMs and quality and length of time and all that. Are we really paying for what we want? Are we really paying for the attention that we want to drive? Or are we still paying for the time that is relative? Because the study has proven time is not going to get you the attention necessarily, and definitely not impact. So with that, thank you so much. I would be very happy to present this to anybody if they want, in their organizations, to their agencies, to their brand marketeers, etc., because we truly believe this is the future, and we are here to help you shape the future. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Rohit Dadwal, once again, ladies and gentlemen.